The revolution will be live.
Received a tremendous response for revoking former CIA Director John Brennan's security clearance, and he expects that he will revoke more. Tremendous response based on condemnation from dozens of former intelligence officers, the embarrassment expressed by the admiral who oversaw the raid that killed Osama bin Laden, rejection and support from members of Congress. Yes, tremendous response, that's clear. But what the administration has not been clear about is why the president did it. I want you to listen to the conflicting justifications from the press secretary and from her boss, the president.
Any benefits that senior officials might glean from consultations with Mr. Brennan are now outweighed by the risks posed by his erratic conduct and behavior.
Look, I say it again, that whole situation is a rigged witch hunt.
Make sense? Well, this is not new. It's not even the first time it's happened this week. After former staffer Omarosa Manigault Newman said that she heard a recording of the president using the N-word multiple times, the president tweeted, "There are no tapes. I don't have that word in my vocabulary." The very next day, Sanders said that she could not guarantee that there is no tape. And they say Omarosa is not credible. Now, you can understand why Sanders created some daylight between herself and the president. She's given full-throated endorsements to his claims in the past that have turned out not to be true many times. According to the Washington Post fact-checker blog, the president has made 4,229 false claims or misleading claims while in office. On average, that's more than 7 a day. Let's now bring in our guest, Michael Williams. He is state senator here in the state of Georgia, and we're appreciative of you coming back to the show.
Oh, it's a pleasure being here. Always enjoy it.
So let's first start with this concept of the president, the administration saying that Omarosa is not credible. I want you to watch this series of statements over the last year and a half from the administration.
Sure.
Isn't it true that the president had already decided to fire James Comey and he asked the Justice Department to put together the rationale for that firing?
No.
President Trump made the right decision at the right time to accept the recommendation.
Regardless of recommendation, I was going to fire Comey.
So he didn't have anything to do with the statement that Don Jr. put out that was being worked on with his team?
I wasn't involved in the statement drafting at all, nor was the president.
The president weighed in as a father. He did not dictate the statement.
The president did dictate a short but accurate response to the New York Times article on behalf of his son.
The Congresswoman stood up, and in the long tradition of empty barrels making the most noise, stood up there and all of that and talked about how she was instrumental in getting the funding for that building. She sat down.
I was not even in Congress in 2009 when the money for the building was secured. So that's a lie.
To summarize, the allegations against Rob Porter are serious and deeply troubling. They were investigated as part of the background check, as this process is meant for such allegations. It was not completed, and Rob Porter has since resigned.
The FBI submitted a partial report on the investigation in question in March, and then a completed background investigation in late July.
We were asked about whether the president knew about this payment his longtime lawyer made to facilitated, rather, Stormy Daniels.
There was no knowledge of any payments from the president.
Funneled through a law firm, and the president repaid it.
Oh, I didn't know he did.
Yep.
So, Senator, after all of that, I mean, how does this administration have the authority to say someone else is not credible?
Well, first of all, he's the president of the United States. The people of this country elected him to do what he is doing right now, and he is shaking up Washington, D.C. He's draining that swamp. And what we're seeing is a lot of backlash from that. Are there some personal issues that he might have? Sure, he's a human, just like you and I. But he's doing what the people want, and that's the positive response that he's getting.
When you say personal issues, is that personal problems with the truth? Because what we just watched was a series over a year and a half of the president saying one thing, the administration saying something else, and then the truth coming out later.
No, he doesn't have a problem with the truth. He goes out there and he does what he feels like is right for our country. He does what, again, the American people elected him to do, which is, like I just said, to drain the swamp. It has nothing to do with the truth.
But
and if you will,
Well, let me stop you here, because everything has something to do with the truth. I mean, for you to say he doesn't have a problem with the truth, he's doing what the country elected him to do, as if those things are mutually exclusive.
No, no, they're not. Okay, let's go back to all the criticism that you guys listed out. The ex-CIA director having his security clearance revoked.
Yes.
They're attacking him. The political elite are attacking him from doing that. The people, the American people, we're fine with that. And why are the political elite attacking President Trump? Because it's affecting their wallet, their pocketbook. The people that are having these high clearances after they leave government service, they get paid a lot of money to be on advisory boards and councils and all kinds of stuff to help private companies with the information they have.
Well, first, I find it interesting that a state senator and candidate for governor is sitting across from me and putting himself outside of the political elite. But let me go back to the heart of your question here, because the reporting from the Washington Post is that they have now prepared documents for the president to sign to revoke more security clearances, and they're just waiting for the optimum time to use them as distractions. Does that not hollow out the entire premise if they believe that these men and women are abusing their privilege of having this and putting national secrets in jeopardy? Why wait? If it's a problem, do it today.
If it's a problem, definitely do it today. Do I know why they're going to wait? I don't know why. But to say that the Washington Post says that, to believe that as being critical when they have always been against the president, I can't take that as a valid source.
Do you believe the press is the enemy of the people?
I believe the press is conflicted right now. I believe that the press has a responsibility to make a profit, to make money, and also a desire to report. And when you look at the various news channels out there, whether it's Fox, whether it's CNN, they are presenting information that goes out to their base so they can get clicks and eyeballs. And they are more concerned about making money than about delivering real news.
Okay. So you believe that this conversation we're having right now is just fake news?
No, I didn't say that. I didn't say that.
Okay. So tell me what, on the concept of the president's attack on the media, I've asked you if you believe that the media is the enemy of the people.
Well, let me ask you this question.
Isn't how this works. I ask the questions, you give the answers. We both have roles here.
I'll answer that question by saying, why has the press not talked about how Facebook and Apple and several of these media companies have stripped Alex Jones?
Oliver Darcy has been on this story for CNN and has been doing it online and on television. And I see you read the president's tweets this morning. So we have indeed talked about it. Let me go to this. I want to talk about Omarosa and this book. Yeah. She claims that she has heard the president use the N-word on recording multiple times. The president says he has it. Mm-hmm. The White House says we can't say one way or the other. She can't guarantee that there is no recording. Would it matter to you if he had?
Yes, it would matter. It would matter as an individual. Mm-hmm. It would not necessarily matter to me as the person that is running our country. The reason I separate those two is
how.
I was about to explain.
Okay.
He has his personal beliefs, his personal ideas, but I truly believe he is able to separate those from how he is running the country.
So you say this is an important point here.
Yeah.
That for you as a man, Donald Trump using the N-word, you personally would have a problem with that.
Yes.
But you don't have a problem with the office of the president using the N-word.
He did not use the N-word as the office of the president. In that office, he used it outside his personal life. If he was president and he goes on TV and uses the N-word, yes, I would have a major problem with that. But he did it before he was president.
Wait a minute. He did it before he was president, so it's okay?
Again, no, I never said it was okay. Again, it's always wrong for me individually.
Yes.
But as the president...
What is the distinction you're creating here with the N-word? That there's one situation in which I have a problem with it, but there's another one that it's okay.
No, I always have a problem with the use of it.
Okay.
I don't have a problem with Donald Trump having used it in the past as my president. I would always say using the N-word is wrong and it's bad and should never be accepted in our society. But just because he might have done it years ago, not as our president, doesn't mean that we need to continue to berate him because he used it. And also, let's go back in time. How old is Donald Trump? 70 years old?
72.
50 years ago, we were not in the society that we are in now where people freely use that word.
We're not talking about a 16-year-old Donald Trump using the N-word. We're talking about potentially a 55, 60, 65-year-old Donald Trump using the word.
Do you know how old he is when he uses it?
I don't know how old he is.
No,
but
I don't
question
either.
Is,
but
why does it matter
you
to you?
You can't say if he's 16
you say,
or if he's 60.
This is not where I expected
know.
This conversation to go, Senator. So let me, I do want to go to military. But the idea that I have a state official sitting across from me saying right now that I'm okay with my president having used it because it happened before he was in office. I mean, tell me if I'm getting this wrong.
To be clear, personally, it is always wrong. It is always wrong to use that word.
But
as the president today, he has not used that word. As the president today, he has not done that. To hold somebody accountable for something he did years ago, as our president today, I think it sets a bad precedent.
So if the tape comes out, your defense is to hold him accountable today for what he said when he was a television host is a bad precedent?
I think you can set it for a lot of bad things, yeah.
Okay. We're going to put a comma there at that conversation. I've got to get to other things here, but that's an important distinction you created right there. Let me talk now about this military parade. The president is married to the idea of having this grand gesture, mm-hmm. right? You support the idea of this parade?
I do.
Okay, tell me why.
Donald Trump's campaign platforms was to make America great again, to bring back American exceptionalism, to take pride in our country. And this is just one of those ways that he wants to do that, because not only are we the economic capital of the world, we're also the military power of mm-hmm. the world. And let's celebrate that, let's embrace that, let's not abuse it,
yeah.
but let's accept it, embrace it, and show the world that we are.
Let me ask you this. The president is at Bedminster. This is the, and let's put up the numbers, the 148th day that the president is one of his golf properties, not the restaurants, not the other ones. He's at one of his golf properties. He's been in office for about 575 days, I believe it is. More than a quarter of his presidency he spent at a Trump golf property. Not one day with the troops in Afghanistan. If he wants to make some grand gesture, why not, as president, go and speak? He's a wartime president. Mm-hmm. Why not go and speak to his troops at war?
I'm not going to sit here and second guess why the president hasn't gone and spoken to the troops while he's playing golf. I don't know the answers to that. What I do know is that he truly loves this country. He truly loves those people, those men and women that are out there fighting for our country.
Then why not go and thank them face to face?
Well, he's doing that by giving them pay raises, by trying to put more money in the budget. Do you think they would prefer him to go out there to Afghanistan and say, hey, guys, well, I appreciate what you're doing, or let me fight for you in Congress so I can give you more money so you can take care of your family and your kids and your wife?
Let's just be clear that this president, although he did, yes, sign into law a pay raise for the military, it's not the first. It's been going on for decades.
I never said it was the first, but, okay, he's out there fighting for pay raises for the military.
You put that feather in his cap as if it makes him unique. This president is unique in the case that it's now been 575 days of his administration, and this wartime president has not gone to speak with his troops in the arena there in Afghanistan. But he's got time to go and play golf for one, or go to his golf properties, 148 days of a 575-day administration.
Yeah. Also, Donald Trump is a business guy, and to be an effective business guy, you have to delegate. The CEO of a multi-billion dollar company cannot do everything. He cannot be the person that does every single task. He has people in leadership in the military that he respects, that he honors, that, again, that he hand-chose, that's going out there and doing that. And, again, he is fighting for what he feels like is most important, that's making sure they have money to take care of their family.
He's the commander-in-chief.
He is.
He's the commander-in-chief. You can't delegate that.
He's not delegating the commander-in-chief. He's delegating who is talking to the troops while he's back at home fighting for their livelihood.
Okay. State Senator Michael Williams, always good to have you on the show.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.